Welcome back to BJGH Education. My name is Stephen, and this is the continuation of our series on the Acts of the Apostles, the Changing of God's episode number 10. Now, back in episode number 9, we saw the inbreaking of the kingdom of God through the sign that was performed by the apostles Peter and John, that is, the healing of the crippled man. He said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And the man went walking and leaping and praising God. And everyone in the temple vicinity was gathered around to listen to the proclamation of the gospel. They were all amazed, but not everyone is happy about this. So let's look at Acts chapter 4, verses 1 to 22. "And as they were speaking to the people, the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them, greatly annoyed because they were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead." So the response from the temple authorities, this is basically the establishment, the priest, the captain of the temple, who's second in command of the high priest, and the Sadducean party come to arrest Jesus. Why? Because they were annoyed that they were teaching the people. That is a no-no, because teaching, that's the job of the priest and the temple authorities, the Sanhedrin, not these upstarts from Galilee. So they feel threatened a little. Hey, you know, that's our job. But specifically, that they were proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. Just not that many days ago, they were the ones who crucified Jesus. And now they are saying that Jesus rose from the dead. What utter nonsense. Besides, the Sadducees do not believe in the resurrection from the dead. And they arrested them and put them in custody until the next day. Why? Because they have a particular law. Monetary cases are tried in the day. This is in Mishnah Sanhedrin, and may be completed at night, but you have to try in day. Whereas capital cases are tried in the day and must be completed during the day. Monetary cases are completed on the same day as they were started, whether to acquit or to render liable, whereas capital cases may be completed on the same day as they were started if the verdict is to acquit, but must be completed on the next day if the verdict is to convict. Regardless, they are to be tried during the day. So they put them in custody until the next day. But did they do the same thing for Jesus? Did they wait until it was daytime to try him so that there will be witnesses? No, they captured him at night, and then they tried him at night. It was a kangaroo court. But nonetheless, all right, this time they put the apostles in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. But many of those who had heard the word believed, and the number of the men came to about 5,000. The response was overwhelming. The people were on the apostles' side because they saw the miracle. They saw the sign of the inbreaking of the kingdom of God. The number of men who believed came to about 5,000. But on the next day, their rulers and elders and scribes gathered together in Jerusalem. That's basically the Sanhedrin, with Annas, the high priest, and Caiaphas, and John, and Alexander, and all who were of the high priestly family. So with the assembled leaders of Israel, 71 members, Annas the high priest, he's the de facto high priest, he has been replaced by his son-in-law, by the Romans, by Caiaphas, but actually Annas is the real power behind the scenes. So basically we have Annas, Caiaphas, John, Alexander, all who were of the high priestly family. So this is the who's who in Jerusalem. This is the who's who of Judaism, rulers, elders, and scribes. Now, what they want to know is this: by what power or by what name did you do this? For them, it is all about power. It is all about authority. What is the source of your authority? Well, what is the sources of power? The temple. the in charge of the temple, political power, credentials. They went to some kind of a school to train to be a rabbi or to be trained to be a priest. And of course, Rome. After all, Caiaphas was the high priest because of Rome. So, but what power do they do what they do? The temple. Credentials. Rome. But by what power then? And by what name would the apostles do all this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers of the people and elders. So this is some kind of a clash of power, isn't it? Between the old aristocratic power and the power of the Holy Spirit that filled the apostles. Rulers of the people and elders, if we are being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man is standing before you. Well, so what the new leaders of Israel, Peter and John, want the old leaders to know is this: an incontrovertible miracle has happened. It cannot be denied. This man who was crippled is sitting by the beautiful gate. Everybody knows him walking in and out, and he's begging for alms. And now this man has this spiritual revival, isn't it? Because the healing here, right? Sozo, it means to save. It is not just physical, but it is holistic. It caused the man to leap up and walk and praising God. This was done by the name of Jesus, the Messiah, the Jewish Messiah. Jesus, the Messiah of Nazareth, and you old leaders of Israel had crucified the promised Messiah of Israel. But God had a different take. God disagreed with your action. God raised Jesus from the dead, and so now you are in trouble. Okay, so this was basically what Peter was saying. What gumption these new leaders of Israel had. So what's the source of the apostles' power? The temple, institution, Rome, politics? No. The source of the apostles' power was the Holy Spirit, God himself. So this Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone, and there is salvation in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. And this comes from Psalm 118. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. So this is the gate of the temple, isn't it? And right now, Peter and John and the temple authorities, they were all there right in the temple. So the context, the setting is just perfect. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we pray, O Lord. O Lord, we pray, give us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. So this stone that the builders rejected was probably when they were building the temple, there was this particular stone that was rejected by the builders, but eventually ended up as the cornerstone. And this was probably metaphorical for Israel, isn't it? Or the king of Israel being rejected by the empire builders of the world, Assyria, whether it was Babylon, whether it was Egypt, and they have rejected Israel or Israel's king as a substandard, as irrelevant, but now it has become cornerstone. And Peter, like Jesus himself, applied these metaphor to the relationships between the leaders of Israel and Jesus. That is, Jesus is the stone that was rejected by the supposed builders of God's kingdom, the temple authorities, but they have rejected him, and now he has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated, not to mean that they do not know how to read and write necessarily, but that they were lay people, unschooled in theology, common men, they were astonished. And then they realized, they had been with Jesus, but seeing the man who was healed standing beside them, the whole time, this healed man was standing right beside them. They had nothing to say in opposition. So they came out with a crippled response. It was absolutely lame. They were astonished at the boldness of the apostles, given that the latter are perceived as theologically untutored laymen, but then they realized that the apostles have been with Jesus, so they have nothing to say in opposition to the apostolic claims about Jesus due to the irrefutability of the miraculous healing. But when they had commanded them to leave the council, they conferred with one another, saying, "What shall we do with this man? For that a notable sign has been performed through them is evident to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it." Well, then don't. But this did nothing to move the Sanhedrin to repentance, isn't it? For the old leaders were more interested in the status quo, even though they saw a notable sign of the kingdom. And this, to me, is tremendously sad. Is it possible for us to know the truth, to see the truth, to understand the truth, to not be put in a place where the truth is undeniable, but because of position, because of power, because of reputation, because of what it means for me and my family, because it may have some negative impact, you would rather suppress it? May that never be true of any of us. But in order that it may spread no further among the people, let us warn them to speak no more to anyone in this name. So they called them and charged them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. So the warning, do not speak or teach in the name of Jesus, so that it does not spread further among the people. How lame a response. It is unbelievable. This is all that the leaders of Israel had, the old leaders. So now is the time for the changing of guards of the leadership of Israel to be transferred from the temple authorities to the apostles of the Messiah. But Peter and John answered them, "Whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you rather than to God, you must judge. For we cannot but speak of what we have seen and heard." So they have this defiant reply, isn't it, by the new leaders. It is impossible for the apostles to comply with the Sanhedrin's ruling, authoritative and binding as they are in Israel society, for doing so would not be right in the sight of God. Why? Because the apostles are witnesses to the resurrection and ascension of Jesus, the Messiah. They cannot say that we didn't see the resurrection of Jesus, we didn't see the ascension of Jesus. He's the Messiah, and we must follow the Messiah, because the Messiah comes from God. We must listen to God. We cannot. So you see, yes, you are authoritative in some sense, but now we have seen something new from God, and we cannot obey what you ask us to do. You are practically irrelevant, because we are the ones who saw the resurrection and ascension of Jesus. And when they had further threatened them, they let them go, finding no way to punish them because of the people. For all were praising God for what had happened. For the man on whom this sign of healing was performed was more than 40 years old. So this is all they could do, threatening and letting go. You couldn't punish them. Why? Because the people are siding with the new leaders of Israel. There has been a changing of gods, so all they could come up with were empty threats. The old leaders of Israel were unable to enforce their ruling on the new leaders of Israel. They were unable to punish the apostles because the people are praising God for what had transpired. So the old leaders were reduced to making empty threats. This is due to the incontrovertible proof that the kingdom of God has arrived. The man on whom this sign of healing is performed is more than 40 years old. But here's the thing. You know that this was a proof that the kingdom of God has arrived. Why wouldn't you repent? Why wouldn't you? Is there anything in our lives today that prevents us from fully embracing the truth of Jesus Christ that is right before our eyes? If God, the Holy Spirit, is to move today and cause a great revival to happen in our lifetime, will we be left behind, so to speak? Will we be sitting on the sidelines due to certain institutional presuppositions, let's just say, or position, or ideas, or this, or that, or the other thing? Or will we willingly give everything up because this is all that matters? May we all be empowered by the Holy Spirit, who is the true source of authority. So there was a changing of guards between the Sanhedrin, the old leaders of Israel, to the apostles, the new leaders of Israel. In terms of source of power, the Sanhedrin, the old leaders of Israel, relied on the temple, credentials, and Rome, whereas the apostles, the new leaders of Israel, is empowered by the Holy Spirit. In terms of education, the Sanhedrin members, they graduated from rabbinical schools, whereas the apostles, the education was the Messiah, Jesus of Nazareth. And on the Messiah, the Sanhedrin rejected and crucified him, whereas the apostles, the new leaders of Israel, witnessed his resurrection and ascension. And how do they demonstrate power? The Sanhedrin with threats, arrests, beatings, death sentences, whereas the apostles, it is the healing, salvation, proclamation of the good news of the Messiah. And that is the difference, the changing of guards. And that is all for this episode. We will continue to look at what happened after this in episode number 11. God bless you.